Welcome. In this video, we are going to develop a .NET MAUI weather app and explore the exciting part of .NET MAUI development, which is API integration. This is a must-watch video as we'll explore the essential tips of implementing APIs correctly and highlight common mistakes that can significantly affect your app's performance. So, get ready for an immersive journey into the secrets of successful app development. Let's dive right in. As we continue our app development journey, let's dive deeper into the WeatherStack API and its various features. In our app, we are utilizing the API provided by WeatherStack. You can find the link to their website in the video description. Click on the link to open the website and explore the rich offerings they provide. To access the WeatherStack API, you'll need to sign up for a new account to obtain your unique API key. It's a simple process that grants you the access to their services and allows you to make the API calls. When you visit the website, you'll notice that the WeatherStack mentions their valued customers who have benefited from their API. It's inspiring to see how their services have made a positive impact on a wide range of users. As you navigate through the website, you'll discover the different types of API methods available. These methods allow you to retrieve specific weather information based on your needs. WeatherStack provides sampled responses of the current weather API, giving you a glimpse of the data you can expect to receive. Now let's take a look at the Weather History API. When you consume this API, you'll receive a response that contains historical weather data. This information can be invaluable for various applications and analysis purposes. Additionally, WeatherStack offers the Weather Forecast API, which provides detailed weather predictions for specific locations. By utilizing this API, you can retrieve accurate and up-to-date weather forecasts. On the homepage of the WeatherStack website, you will find some basic details about their services and offerings. However, let's take a moment to explore their pricing details. It's important to note that the pricing information I'm sharing with you right now is accurate at the time of recording this video. However, do keep in mind that there might be changes when you check their website. Always refer to the latest information available to make informed decisions. Now let's move on to the documentation page. Here, you will find detailed documentation of the API methods. When implementing a third-party API, it's crucial to go through the documentation to gain a comprehensive understanding of the available methods and their usages. Within the documentation, WeatherStack also mentions the error codes that you may encounter when making API calls. Familiarizing yourself with these error codes will help you troubleshoot and handle any issues effectively. Furthermore, the documentation highlights various API features, providing insight into the specific details you can receive in the API response. This knowledge will empower you to retrieve the necessary weather data for your app with precision. The documentation also covers specific API details such as the historical weather API and the weather forecast API. These sections provide information how to utilize these APIs effectively to access past and future weather data. Under the general options section, you will find the different types of query values that you can send to the API. The first option is providing a location name where you can simply send the name of the location and receive relevant weather information. Another option is providing the zip code specifically for countries like the US, Canada, and the UK. If you have coordinates available, you can provide them as input to obtain precise weather data. WeatherStack also offers the option to retrieve weather information based on the IP address. Additionally, you can use the fetch:ip option, which automatically identifies the device IP address, location, and provides the weather information accordingly. Further down the documentation, you will find the details about units and languages supported by the API. This allows you to customize the data you receive according to your preferred units and language settings. For our specific application, we need to fetch the current weather information by providing coordinates. This will ensure that we receive real-time weather data for the location of interest. Now that we have a clear understanding of the WeatherStack API and its features, Let's proceed with the development of our .NET MAUI Weather App. To begin, I have created a new .NET MAUI App project. Before we dive into the project, I want to mention that this video is part of our .NET MAUI tutorial series. If you are interested in exploring more tutorials and expanding your knowledge, you can find the playlist link in the video description. Now, let's focus on developing our project. First, we'll add a folder named Pages inside our project. This will help organize our app's content. Within the Pages folder, I'm adding a new content page and naming it Weather Info Page. This page will serve as the main content area for displaying weather information. Moving on, we'll navigate to the app.xaml.cs class and assign the newly created content page as the main page of our application. This ensures that the weather info page will be the initial page displayed to the user. Now, let's clean up the content page. We can remove the auto-created label inside the vertical stack layout as we won't be needing it. To enhance the page appearance, I'm assigning a title and a background color to the content page. This will give it a more polished and cohesive look. Next, we'll focus on the user input section. We'll place entry fields inside a frame for the user to enter the coordinates. To ensure proper alignment, we'll utilize the grid control. Inside the grid, we'll add an entry field for latitude and another one for longitude. These input fields will allow users to enter the specific coordinates they want to retrieve weather information for. Moving on, we'll place a button below the entry fields. This button will serve as a trigger to fetch the weather details from the API. Once we receive the weather data from the API, we can display it below. We'll start by placing an image control to display an image related to the weather. This image URL will be obtained from the API response. Following that, we'll add a label to display the temperature. The actual text for the temperature will be updated later based on the API data. Additionally, we'll include another label to display a brief description of the weather, providing users with an overview of the current conditions. To present the location details, we'll add another label below the weather description label. Moving further down, we'll include additional values like humidity and cloud covering level. To ensure proper alignment, we'll utilize the grid control once again. Within a frame, we'll display the humidity value. In another frame, we'll present the cloud cover level. This value will be represented as a percentage. Lastly, we'll use another frame to display whether it is currently day or night, indicated by a yes or no value. With this design in place, we are ready to run the project and observe the app's appearance in the emulator. In the emulator, you can see that we have entry fields for latitude and longitude, along with a button to initiate the weather information retrieval. The design also includes sections to display various information obtained from the API. Our design is now complete, providing a user-friendly interface to input coordinates and view corresponding weather details. The next step is to create a view model for the content page. We have already discussed view model implementation in detail in our previous video, so feel free to refer back to that for a deeper understanding. To keep our project organized, let's create a folder named Models within the project. In the Models folder, we'll create another folder named View Models. This will help us maintain a structured project layout. Now let's proceed to create a class named Weather Info Page View Model within the View Models folder. But before we proceed, it's necessary to install the community-toolkit.mvvm library from NuGet packages. Here you can see the library at the top of the list. Upon installation, we can continue by making our class a partial class. This is important because community-toolkit.mvvm library also create classes with the same name. Next, let's create the necessary properties for our view model. We'll start by creating properties for the latitude and longitude, which we'll use to search for weather data. To ensure seamless data binding, we can provide observable property attribute for these properties. At this point, you may notice an error being displayed. This error occurs because we haven't inherited the class from the observable object class provided by the community-toolkit.mvvm library. This class is essential for proper data binding functionality. Moving on, we'll create additional properties for the weather icon, temperature, weather description, location, humidity, cloud cover level, and whether it is day or night. These properties will store the retrieved weather information. In addition to the properties, we'll also create a method to fetch the weather information from the API. To bind this method to the button's command property, we should provide the relay command attribute. This ensures that when the button is clicked, the associated method in the view model will be triggered. Now, let's proceed with binding the view model values to the corresponding controls in the XAML file. First, we'll import the namespace of the view model class into the XAML file. This will allow us to access the view model within the XAML file. Then, we'll specify the data type of the content page to be the view model class. This establishes the connection between the view model and the content page. To enable data binding, we'll bind the latitude property to the first entry control and the longitude property to the second entry control. This allows the user's input to be captured and stored in the view model. For the button's command property, we'll bind it to the fetch weather information command we created earlier. This ensures that when the button is clicked, the associated method in the view model will be executed. We'll continue by binding the remaining properties to their respective controls. This includes weather icon, temperature, weather description, location, humidity, cloud cover level, and whether it is day or night. With these data bindings in place, our view model is now connected to the user interface, enabling seamless updates and interactions. Before we proceed with implementing the API, let's take a moment to test it using Postman. Postman is a powerful tool that allows us to interact with the APIs and analyze their responses. To begin, I'll create a new request in Postman. Since we are fetching current weather information, the request type will be GET, as this API method follows the GET protocol. I'll provide the API base URL in the request. The specific API method we'll be using is called current. As mentioned in the API documentation, we need to pass a parameter named query as a query string. For this parameter, we'll provide the coordinates separated by a comma, as specified in the API documentation. The next parameter we need to include is the access key, which we obtain after signing up for a new account on WeatherStack website. For testing purposes, I'll use my own access key as the parameter value. Now, let's send the request and observe the response. As you can see, we have successfully received a response from the API. Within the response, we have valuable information. For instance, there is an image URL mentioned as the weather icon. This URL can be used to display relevant weather icons in our application. Additionally, we have access to the location information, providing us with the specific details about the retrieved weather data. To streamline our development process, I'll copy the entire response content from Postman. This content will be instrumental in creating a model class that allows us to effectively map and utilize the retrieved weather data within our application. In our project, I'll create a new folder called API Models inside the Models folder. This folder will house the classes related to the API response models. Next, I'll create a class named Weather API Response within the API Models folder. To simplify this process, I'll utilize a feature in Visual Studio. I'll place the cursor below our class, open the Edit menu, and select Paste Special. From there, I'll choose Paste JSON as classes. Visual Studio will automatically generate the required classes based on the JSON structure we copied from Postman. To align with naming conventions, I'll modify the class names, ensuring that they all start with Weather API Response. Additionally, I'll include the JSON property name attribute for each property. This attribute allows us to assign custom names for the properties while ensuring the correct names are used during serialization or deserialization of JSON data. I'll make the necessary adjustments for the remaining properties as well. With our model class setup, let's create a class named Constants within our project. In this class, we'll define important constants related to the API integration. We'll create a string constant to hold our API key and another constant for API base URL. You can provide your API key in the appropriate constant. Moving on, I'll create a folder named Services within our project. Inside this folder, I'll create a class named Weather API Service. This class will handle the API calls and integration. To ensure a proper implementation, I'll declare the HTTP client object as read-only. Then, inside the constructor, we can initiate the HTTP client object. It's crucial to note that one of the best practices when working with HTTP client is to instantiate it once and reuse it throughout the application's lifespan. Creating new instances for each API call can lead to performance issues. Next, I'll assign the base address of the HTTP client using the constant we defined for the API base URL. Now, let's implement the method responsible for fetching the weather information. This method, named getWeatherInformation, will return the weather API response object as a result. It accepts two parameters, latitude and longitude, both of which are strings since we need to provide these values in the URL. Before making the API call, we'll check if the device has an internet connection. If there is no internet, we'll return null. Otherwise, we'll proceed with the API call and return the object generated from the JSON result. Now, let's navigate to the ViewModel class and implement the fetchWeatherInformation method. But before that, we'll declare the Weather API service as read-only and instantiate it within the constructor. Within the fetchWeatherInformation method, we'll call the service method to retrieve the Weather API response object. Afterward, we'll check if the object is not null, indicating a successful API call. If it is not null, we can assign the values for our view model properties accordingly. For example, we can extract the first element from the weather icon array and assign it to the corresponding view model property. Similarly, we'll set the temperature, location, weather description, humidity, cloud cover level, and whether it is day or night. Now, let's run the application and encounter the error we expect while calling the API. I'll provide the coordinates and click the fetch button. As anticipated, we received an error message stating clear text HTTP traffic to the URL is not permitted. This occurs because our API URL uses HTTP, and starting from Android 9, there are restrictions on clear text or unencrypted HTTP traffic by default. To resolve this, we have two options. Either switch to HTTPS URL, that is the preferred method, or allow clear text HTTP traffic in our application. Allow me to demonstrate how to enable clear text HTTP traffic. Let's navigate to the Platforms folder, expand the Android folder, and open the Android manifest.xml file. In the application tag, we can set the value for Android colon users clear text traffic to true. Now, let's run the project again. As I provide the coordinates as before and click the fetch button, we can see that the data is successfully populated in the content page. It displays values such as temperature, location, humidity, and more. Let's experiment with different coordinates. As I do so, the displayed data updates accordingly. This demonstrates that our app is capable of effectively consuming the API and retrieving the desired weather information. And that concludes our tutorial on developing a weather app using .NET MAUI and API integration. You have learned valuable skills for building powerful apps. Stay tuned for more exciting tutorials in our .NET MAUI series. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe for future updates. Remember, this is just the beginning. The possibilities are endless when it comes to enhancing your app's functionality and user experience. Don't forget to check out the other videos in our .NET MAUI tutorial series by clicking the playlist link in the video description. Happy coding, and see you in the next video.